The fellowship and love on everybody mode this afternoon, but we want to love on the Lord and we want to celebrate His goodness. So if y'all will stand with me, we're going to begin our night of worship. I'm so glad you're here. We're honored to have Pastors Tommy and Elaine Hayes with us.
Welcome.
Welcome. We're honored you're with us tonight. Looking forward to getting to know you. And always glad to have the rest of you here. We are going to, just to give you an idea of where we're headed tonight. Obviously, we're going to worship. But we are in the midst of the Feast of Tabernacles. And so I'm going to teach tonight on the Tabernacle of Moses, because it's the pattern God released out of heaven for how we are to enter into worship. And it actually is a revelation of a seat of government, because it was out of that place that Moses heard from heaven and he governed. And he led the children of Israel out of that place. And it is a picture of how we are to move. The Lord said to me a couple of weeks ago or so that this Feast of Tabernacles will turn into a gate of tabernacling, a city gate, if you will, of ecclesias gathering from place to place all across this nation to govern, even in the midst of our enemies. That we will govern as the ecclesia. We're going to move into a new dimension of understanding what that means. And I just felt like if we're going to do that, we need to understand what is held within the Tabernacle of Moses, because it gives so much insight into how God has established a place on the earth, even as it is in heaven. So I just want you to know where we're going. So as we worship, I want you to be free. I want you to move around. I want you to get into your place of worship and exalt the King. He is the King of all. He is the government. There is no government apart from Him. So, Lord, we exalt You in this place tonight. We declare that You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. You are the majestic one. You are the one who rules and reigns on high. And You have called us as Your people to rule and reign on the earth out of Your heart. So, Lord, tonight, let celebration arise in this place by the power of Holy Spirit, that we move with You. I declare and decree that we are in alignment with heaven, and we are listening, Holy Spirit, to do what You tell us to do tonight, that we will move in agreement with You, knowing that as we do that, the holy angels are moving with us to bring Your kingdom on earth, even as it is in heaven. So, Lord, let this be a place of tabernacles tonight. Let this be a place where Your presence and Your glory so manifest in this place that no flesh can glory in Your presence, but we will be demonstrations of Your glory in the earth. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
As David did in Jehovah's sight, I will dance with all my might before the King of Kings. As Miriam did with the tambourine, I will clap my hands and sing before the King of Kings.
Come on, we can come.
Jericho, we will shout to defeat the foe before the King of Kings. We can Jesus made a way.
Come on, as David did.
As David did in Jehovah's sight, I will dance with all my might before the King of Kings. As Miriam did with the tambourine, I will clap my hands and sing before the King of Kings. We can come before Him and worship Him today. We can now adore Him. Jesus made a way. Judah did on the battleground, we will make a joyful sound before the King of Kings. As Joshua did at Jericho, we will shout to defeat the foe before the King of Kings. For we can come before Him, worship Him today. We can now adore Him. Jesus made a way.
Come on, we can come.
We can come before. Worship Him today. We can now adore Him. Jesus made a way. Let God arise, let God arise, let God arise, let God arise.
Come on, let God arise in this place.
Let God arise, let God arise. Let God arise, let God arise. Let His enemies be scattered, let the righteous be glad. Yes, let them rejoice with gladness, God has triumphed mightily. Let God arise.
God arise.
Let God arise.
the midst of this crying out for let God arise, I want us to declare that over the president and first lady, that God arises on their behalf. Lord, we declare and decree that you are rising over President John the Beloved Trump, and you are rising over First Lady Melania Trump. You are rising and showing yourself strong over them, that even as they are tabernacled in during this quarantine time, that you are tabernacling in with them. We declare and decree that every evil plot of the enemy that has been set against them and therefore set against our nation shall not prosper in the thing for which it is sent. But your purposes shall be accomplished in our president and first lady and in this nation. We declare and decree that righteousness, justice, and truth are ruling and reigning in our nation, and they shall advance in power, purity, and passion in Jesus' name.
God arise, let God arise, let God just be glad. Yes, let them rejoice with gladness. God is triumphantly. Let his enemies be scattered. Let the righteous be glad. Yes, let them rejoice with gladness. God is triumphantly. Let his enemies be scattered, let the righteous be glad. Yes, let them rejoice with gladness, God is triumphed mightily. Let God arise, let God arise, let God arise. I will praise you with a heart that plays in my heart. To you, my God, my magnificent God. To you, my God, my magnificent God. For into me the brightness of your daybreak. Pour into me your rays of revelation true. Let them lead me to the shining path. Show the way into your burning presence. Praise you with a heart that plays. will praise you with a heart that plays in my heart. To you, my God, my magnificent God. To you, my God, my magnificent God. Pour into me the brightness of your daybreak. Pour into me your rays of revelation true. Let them lead me to the shining path. Show away unto your burning God. To you, our God, our magnificent God. To you alone, my God, you alone, our King. Oh, to you alone, my God, our magnificent God. Just you alone, our King. You alone, our King. Revive us. Revive. Child out playing on their own front door. Every baby laying on the bedroom floor.
Every
dreamer dreaming in the dead end job. Every driver driving through the rush hour mile. I'm in my spirit, feeling in my bones. Gonna send revival, bring them all back home. I can hear that thunder in the distance, like a train on the edge of the town. Can feel the brooding of your spirit
From ministries all over the nation of prodigals coming home. Barbara Yoder out of Flint, Michigan said they baptized 21 last Sunday night, prodigals returning home. And so as we do this, I want you to believe for your prodigals. Nathaniel, where are you? Lord said, have you bring her up here. You can come, both of you. I'll hold the microphone. Or I'll hold her. I'll do one of the two. But I want you to pray for the prodigals to come home. This man has an anointing to pray for prodigals to come home. And I want us, I felt this in this song so strongly. And whatever your prodigal, wherever they are in their journey, do not believe they're too far gone. Don't believe they're too far gone. It's easy when they're way out somewhere and they're hardened and they're resistant. It's hard to believe that they can come home. But remember this, wherever you were when God got you, just say, God, if you got me, you can get them. Nothing is too difficult for you.
Father, I thank you for the rich salvation that comes from the well of Christ. I thank you that your salvation is complete, lacking nothing, that the covenant that was promised of old is ours now. We lay hold of it by faith and we declare it over our sons and daughters and brothers and sisters and family members and friends who have departed because of trauma, because of fear, because of anxiety, unbelief, anger, bitterness, whatever it is, Lord, I thank you that there is no pit too deep that your arm cannot reach, and you are resistant to the hellfire of our own sins. I thank you, Father, for reaching into the fire and pulling me out of homosexuality and pulling me out of addiction and pulling me out of depression and suicide. You reached into my fire of my own making, God, and I know that you show no favoritism. So I'm asking in this hour, Lord, that you would cause those dead bones to rise. You would cause those dead ones to come back to life. We speak life. We speak breath of life over those prodigals now in Jesus' name. Oh, Father, we thank you for the winds of the Spirit coming with your breath, breathing new life, fascination, awe and wonder. You are the Psalm 65 God who answers us with awe and wonder. Lord, you answer us with mighty power. We thank you for demonstrating your faithfulness, every tear, every prayer. We declare the bowls are tipping. The bowls are tipping. The bowls are tipping. The bowls are tipping. Thank you, Jesus.
And Lord, we join our faith and we pray over the Sean Foy gathering to worship in Piedmont Park this week that will be held on Saturday night. We say, Father, release the fire of Holy Spirit over that gathering. Yes. Surround them as with a shield. Release the glory and the wisdom and the revelation that is needed to unlock hearts. God, protect, shield, guard, and then release your fire into the midst of their gathering, that we shall hear the testimonies of thousands coming to know you. God, release salvation in the streets. Release an anointing to bring the prodigals back home. Set those free out of homosexuality. Set them free out of drug addiction. And God, I cry out specifically for those that are bound in the bondages of religion that would deny the power of you, that they would be set free and brought into a divine encounter with you that would loose them forever in the fire of God in Jesus' name.
From the preacher preaching when the well is dry, to the lost soul reaching for a higher high, from the young man working through his hopes and fears, to the widow walking through the veil of tears, every man and woman, every old and young, every father's daughter, every mother's son. I feel it in my spirit, feel it in my bones. You're gonna send revival, bring them all back home.
Now listen here.
To every man and woman, every old and young, every father's daughter, every mother's son. Every father's daughter, every mother's son. Every father's daughter, every mother's son. Every father's daughter, every mother's son.
Stay right there.
Every father's daughter, every mother's son.
Child trafficking.
Every father's daughter, every mother's son.
Because there's somebody's daughter and somebody's son.
Every father's daughter, every mother's son. Every father's daughter, every mother's son. I feel it in my spirit, feel it in my bones. You're gonna send revival, bring it all back home.
Yes, Lord.
Revive us, revive us,
revive us, Lord. Revive us. Revive us with your fire now. Revive us. Revive us. Revive us.
For you to revive us in the fullness of days. Revive us by your Holy Spirit. Break us out of the bondages of the past. Break us out of religious strongholds. Break us out of idolatry, judgmentalism, and rigidity. Revive us to the awakening of your spirit, that we will move as you lead, not by systems and structures that contain, but with a release of the anointing of Holy Spirit that will unlock generations to serve you, that will unlock the brokenhearted into healing, that will release the power of deliverance even into the streets. Lord, that you would do a work in our days, that even if we were to be told the fullness of it, we would not be able to comprehend it. We're believing you, God, for a billion soul harvest in our generation. We're believing you, God, for a church that looks like what you intended us to look like from the beginning. One new man rising to be who you created us to be. That we will look back at the early church and we will see that it is manifesting in our day in maturity with signs, wonders, and miracles. That it won't be a shadow of the past, but it will be a manifestation of a greater glory of the latter temple that you have said you will have in our day. Because we know, Jesus, that you are returning for a bride that is pure and spotless, and one who looks like you, one who acts like you, one who moves like you, that does only what we see the Father doing. That we will be a manifestation of your grace and glory in the earth. And it will be a wonder for all to behold. Not unto us, O God, not unto us be glory, but unto you and to you alone be all the glory, now and forever and ever. In Jesus' marvelous name, amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come quickly, your will be done the same. On earth as it is, in heaven, let heaven come to earth as it is. In heaven, let heaven come.
your will be done the same on earth as it is in heaven. Let heaven come to earth as it is in heaven. Let heaven come. Let heaven.
Worshipers gather in Atlanta. I saw our sound going out over the city of Atlanta declaring heaven of God come. It was like a dew that was settling, a blanket over our city that would go out into the highways and the byways of our state to say, heaven come. Look up here, heaven come. So, Lord, we agree in advance with everything that you're going to be doing next Saturday in Piedmont Park to worship you, the Most High God. And, Lord, as we continue to worship you now and worship you this week, our voice print settles in the atmosphere, and the angelic host of heaven is taking our worship and sowing it into the ground so that those will be drawn into Piedmont Park, lost, saved, heathen, whatever. You're going to bring them in to tell them all about your love, your presence, your care, how much you have longed for the day for them to turn back and look at you face to face. So, Father, we are calling into the highways and the byways and saying, come and meet your Lord who loves you.
who has given it all for you so that heaven can come within you. Will of God will be done in you. You will know, and you will know him, and he will know you. Have your way in the city of Atlanta Saturday. May it be beyond anything we can imagine or hope for, because it is all about your love that I see spreading out now and falling as little dust particles on everyone, that they will look up and come. Have your way. Kingdom of God come. Will of God be in our city and in our state and in our nation.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Yield it and still, Lord. Have thine own way. Have your way, Lord. Have
over this house and over this city, over this state, and even over this nation, that we are being revived, recalibrated, and reset for a greater alignment with heaven, so that the manifestation of heaven on earth becomes greater and greater still. Father, have your way. so that you will be glorified in and through us all. In Jesus' mighty name. Lift up a shout to the Lord our God. Jesus, Jesus, we glorify you. We magnify you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Judah, for leading the way. Wow. Wow. I know some are bringing your offering, and that's fine. Just bring it as the Lord leads. We'll probably, at least my intention is, I'm going to receive an offering at the end. We'll see if I remember. Somebody help me. I want to give a few announcements as we get ready to go into the Word of God. To stay in a place of worship and expectancy, because it's all about what He wants to do. There we go. This week is Reset 2020. The convocation that Dutch Sheets is calling in Middletown, Ohio. It is sold out. But we are live, it is being live streamed, but we're also live streaming here so that you can join in together. There's just something, we did this last year at the starting the year off right in January, and there was such a synergy of being able to join in that we felt this was such a strategic time that it would be very important for us to do the same thing this time. And so plan on coming. I put the times up there. It's Thursday at 7, Friday from 9 to about noon, and 2 to about 4 or 5. I'm taking a little bit of guess on the times. And I know this Friday night session's at 7, and then Saturday starts at 9, and will be done by around noon. Just so you know, and you can be praying for me, I am one of the presenters on Saturday morning. The presentations are only about 10 to 15 minutes. So we have to be very succinct, and it is all about setting apostolic prophetic strategies of intercession for the nation moving forward. I'm very honored to be able to do that, and sometimes my knees knock a little bit, so y'all just pray for me. I feel like I have a word. Part of tonight's message is building into that. With the word of this Feast of Tabernacles is turning into a gate of tabernacling for this nation, for the ecclesia. So the next slide is in next Sunday night. We will have Clay Nash in the house for Sunday night and Monday night on helping us learn and grow in walking in kingdom authority. How many of you need know? We need to know how to walk in kingdom authority. It's not something you just presume. We have to know what it means to walk in authority, and how do we come into an alignment with the authority of the kingdom. And you cannot have authority for anything you're not willing to take responsibility for. So you have a greater measure of authority in within your sphere that you operate in and that has been assigned and confirmed to you by the Lord. And then God expands. He who is faithful in little, He then expands and gives you more. With more authority comes more responsibility. And I don't know all He's going to bring, but I know that's a part of it. And all authority is relational. All authority is relational. You have no authority operating in your life if you don't honor the relationships that God is giving. And then Thursday nights, get my days straight, we are doing for the state of Georgia prayer calls. Now, we will not do this Thursday night. We did one this past Thursday night. We got off to a little bit of a rocky start because I had just gotten in town and a wrong number was posted on Facebook. And anyway, it was a bit crazy, but we got through it. And I forgot to record it. So, you know, but it's okay. The prayers were recorded in heaven. That's all that matters. But for October 15th, 22nd, and 29th, leading into the election, we will be doing a prayer call from 9 to 10 p.m. I am selecting people to come on to pray, and it'll be different people, and I'm expanding it out to some people across the state as we move forward. The Lord said to me, you have got to secure the state of Georgia in the spirit, in righteousness, justice, and truth. It is being contended for. And I'll just tell you, what we are contending for is biblical voting. biblical voting. If you can't vote on biblical principles, stay home. Just stay home. If you can't vote for life, stay home. If you can't vote for righteousness, stay home. Sandra and I made a really quick trip to Savannah on Wednesday and Thursday to meet with Cheyenne and a group of pastors on Thursday morning. And he has started an initiative called One Race for Life. And I've got some flyers up here for y'all to pick up, just one sheet front and back. But the three statements of the mission are: unite all races and cultures within the body of Christ. It's sad that we even have to say that. Through the blood of Jesus, we are one. And as soon as we begin to operate by what the truth is that Christ has already said and already paid the price for, the better off we'll be. We have one blood. It's the blood of Jesus. And if you go all the way back to Adam, we still have one blood. Okay? We just got divided and messed up along the way. And so now it's time for us to believe what God said, the fullness of what Christ paid for, and come into that one new man. Unique, diverse, and beautiful. So, unite. Number two is recruit a new generation of believers to be educated and activated to vote pro-life. I'm trying to decide what to share, but I'm going to say this. I was incredibly grieved, and may I say angered, with a righteous indignation when I was in Savannah on Thursday. Because Cheyenne stood up and he said, I was coming to Atlanta and the church was too divided and I couldn't find a place. Whoever he was working with had gotten him into Ebenezer Baptist, and then he found out that the pastor is grossly liberal, and I'll just say it and stand on it, pro-death, and he pulled because then he couldn't find another place, and I just stood up and repented on behalf of Atlanta. And I said, I'm sorry you didn't find the right people, because there's a remnant in Atlanta that believes like what you're saying. And unfortunately, there are those in our city that are promoting reconciliation between the races, that are standing against righteousness by the way they are treating this election. And I am so grieved that those who are supposedly a part of a prayer movement in this city, and if people are watching, I'll probably get whatever from it, and I really don't care, because it is a stand of righteousness. It's the plumb line of the Lord. And I say, God have mercy. Because we will never have a one race movement that is authentic until we come around life. Because in the state of Georgia, 63% of the abortions in our state are against black babies. I want to let that settle in. 63% of all abortions in our state are taking out the next generation of black babies that could be the next president, could be the next one who finds the cure for cancer, the one who finds the cure for, name it, could be the one who comes up with the greatest witty invention that would transform the nation, much like this crazy iPhone did. I mean, for real, it changed the world.
Genocide.
It is genocide. It is genocide. Yes, Lord. We agree. Lord, I'm going to stand right here and I'm saying in the name of Jesus, forgive your church for standing in a place of compromise. God, I'm asking that you would do something within the people of this city. Begin here with us, God. That we would have an authentic voice in the spirit and in the courts of heaven to stand against the genocide of the generations that have already, that are being aborted day by day. For the 63% of the abortions in our state being to black babies, God, we say forgive us. But God, for the rest, we say forgive us for them too. God, there's no excuse. It is an abomination before you. Every life is precious. Every life is precious. And Lord, I am asking in the name of Jesus for the blinders to come off. For the anointing of the eye salve from heaven to come upon the eyes of believers that are caught in deception and delusion and standing in agreement with hell rather than in agreement with heaven. Father, I ask that you forgive us for the perverting of the word of justice. Lord, we are for justice, your justice, and justice comes for the least and the most vulnerable among us. God, for every place we cry out for justice, but we're condoning death, God, forgive us. Lord, would you release your Holy Spirit over the Church of Atlanta to honor you, to honor life, and to honor one another without regard to division. In 2 Chronicles 5, God, your presence came, your glory came in such a way that no flesh could stand because they came together without regard to division. So, Lord, let us come together without regard to division, without regard to race, without regard to socioeconomic status, without regard to history. Lord, we've all got a history. But, God, it comes under the blood. I'm grateful for the blood. Lord, would you do the supernatural in our midst? And would you bless our city with a movement of men and women, young and old, boys and girls coming together as one for life, for life, for life, young and old. Lord, for the babies, for the weak, for the infirm, for the elderly. We honor you and we honor life. In Jesus' name. The third part of the mission is to mobilize people to register to vote and make the pledge, listen to this, to always vote pro-life. Always. It's a non-negotiable. It's a non-negotiable. Since we're in Georgia tomorrow, if you are not registered to vote, if anybody in here is not registered to vote, get there tomorrow. It's the last day. Do not miss your hour of privilege and responsibility. I'm just going to read the pledge. If you agree, just as I read through it, just say amen. As a believer in Jesus Christ, I am called to be a reformer, world changer, and a history maker. As a reformer, I am making the following pledges to advance God's kingdom, fulfill the Great Commission, and live for the glory of God. Number one, I pledge to always vote pro-life. I will never vote for an elected official that is pro-abortion. This is at every place, every level. You can't just depend on it being the president. Senate, House, the president can only do so much. If our senators and our House of Representatives people don't vote pro-life, the president can't get it done. But I'm going to tell you something. If they overturn Roe v. Wade and they don't, and we don't get it brought in at the state level, which means we have to have state representatives and state senators and mayors and city councilmen, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that are pro-life, we will never get this thing turned around and implemented. You can't just look at the president. So I pledge to vote pro-life. I will never vote for an elected official that is pro-abortion. I recognize that all lives are sacred, including the unborn. Therefore, I will contend for the right of the unborn until abortion is illegal and rare. Amen. Number two, I pledge to always vote for biblical family values. I will defend the sacred covenant of marriage between a man and a woman. Amen. Because if you go the other direction, you're going against life. You're going against God's covenant. You're going against created order. Number three, I pledge to fight racism and biblical injustice. Amen. I will work toward racial reconciliation where there is racial divide in the body of Christ and in society. I'm going to say this on this point. We need to talk about where it's going good rather than focusing on where it's all bad. Because what's happening in the media, they're focusing on how bad it is, but if you really look around, I mean, just in here, look around. This is more common than not. So we need to be celebrating the unity and the relationships that we have and use it as a model to shine brightly out in the midst of culture. We've been too silent, folks. Quit rehearsing the curse. Number four. This is not my message, believe it or not. It's just tapping into something. Number four. I pledge to pray for my president, whether you like him or not. And all those who are in authority over the seven mountains of culture, I will contend for revival in the church and spiritual awakening in my nation. Amen. Let's do it, God. We've got to have it. You can overturn laws all day long. But if until there's a revival and a spiritual awakening of the heart, the laws will do no good. Laws are for the lawless. That's biblical. And we need to get it overturned because those laws speak in heaven. And the blood that is on the earth, on the ground because of the 47 million, or how many? It's more than that. 60-something million now, isn't it? 60. It's an outrageous number over the last 47 years. That blood is crying out from the ground, and it demands an answer. A lot of what we're going through as a nation right now is an answer to the blood being shed in our nation. Number five, I pledge to live a life of love as I constantly receive the love of my Heavenly Father. I commit to love God and love my neighbor as myself. Amen. So these are up here. You can take them. You can, is his website on here? It's not. It's not on here. We'll get it to you because I don't remember where it was. Okay, then looking forward to November 19th through 21st, We're going to have another conference with Greg and Joanne Hood on rebuilding the broken altar. Everything we just talked about is because the altar of the Lord has been broken down. Because we have not been faithful to the altar of the Lord, we've bowed our knee at the altar of Baal and Moloch, Jezebel, Ahab. We have bowed our knee and allowed the altar of the Lord to be broken down. And so Greg has got an incredible new book. If you've gone on the website, there is a registration fee, but here's what I did for everybody on the registration fee. You get a copy of his book. If you're a family, you get one copy. If you want additional ones, you can buy more. But I'm getting at least one into every household. So, and we will have them here hopefully in about 2 weeks. So you may even get a chance to read it ahead of time, which would help the conference. It's really, really good. So Father, thank you for what you're doing tonight. Thank you for what you've already done. And Lord, as I begin to unlock and unpack the teaching and the revelation that you have given over the tabernacle of Moses as a pattern, I'm asking that we would move as one. Lord, that you would bring out of me the things that need to be brought out and cause me just to skip over the things that don't need to be brought out, Lord, because we want to stay on point with you. Lord, you know this is one of my favorite teachings and one that you have used in my own life in amazing ways to encounter you. And so, Lord, I'm just asking that you would grace this time for your purposes and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. I have to get my water. Teresa, if you would adjust the thermostat, it is quite warm back in here. Huh? Turn the air on. Just switch it off auto onto air because it is like, it's usually cold in here, so this is quite a shock. We're usually roasting. Thank you, sir. Woohoo. Okay, Sandra just looked up the website. It is the number one, race, the number four, life.org. So it's the name, and you'll have it on the document when you pick it up. So we're going to look at God tabernacling with his people. And the focus is cultivating a place of his dwelling. How many of you want your life, your home, and this house, and our city, and our state, and our nation to be cultivated as a dwelling place of the Lord? I am not interested in a visitation. I want a habitation. So that the presence and the glory of the Lord so inhabits every aspect of culture that things are forever changed. Because when you encounter his presence, everything changes. 1 Corinthians 3, 9 through 11 says, "For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field and God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me, like a wise master builder," this is Paul speaking, "I laid a foundation and another is building on it. But each man must be careful how he builds on it. For no man can lay a foundation other than the one that is laid, which is Jesus Christ." So in everything that we talk about, I want you to understand Jesus Christ is the foundation. We're looking back to Moses, but Jesus Christ is the foundation. And you're going to see this as I unpack the tabernacle. Because Moses was building according to the heavenly pattern. No other foundation but Jesus. He had a visitation on the mountain, and God showed him how to build the tabernacle. Hebrews 8:5 says, "The priests on earth serve in a temple that is but a copy modeled after the heavenly sanctuary, a shadow of the reality. For when Moses began to construct the tabernacle, God warned him and said, you must precisely follow the pattern I revealed to you on Mount Sinai. If God was that specific about following a pattern, do you think that perhaps he was serious about it? And that it was more than just building something they carried throughout the wilderness. He was showing something out of heaven to release it into the earth so that for all times we would see something about how worship and kingdom government operates in heaven. It's all about how kingdom government operates in heaven, because where God dwells, there is government. Exodus 25, 8 through 9 says, let them construct a sanctuary for me that I may dwell among them. That was God's purpose. He wanted to dwell among them. Do you know what his purpose is today? He wants to dwell among us. According to all that I'm going to show you is the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furniture. Just so you shall construct it. See, it's every detail. Every detail was revealing heavenly government, heavenly operation. It was revealing Jesus from beginning to end. And he is the one upon whom the government rests upon his shoulders. And of the increase of his government, there shall be no end. So when we do things God's way, then we're going to move in to operating according to his government. So it's a revelation of Jesus Christ. It's evidenced in and through the entire tabernacle. The foundation of Jesus, Son of God and Son of Man. Jesus as Lord and Savior of all by the redeeming power of his blood through his death, burial, and resurrection. That Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. John 14:6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Do you remember when Jesus said this? Did everybody like that he said it? They kind of went in an uproar. Do you know why they went in an uproar? Because they knew exactly what he was saying. He wasn't just making something up. They knew exactly what he was saying. So let's discover what he was saying. Jesus as the way. Can we go to the next slide? The first gate of entrance in the tabernacle, I've got an arrow pointed to it so you can see it, was known as the way. So all of Israel would have heard Jesus say, I am the way, and they would have remembered, because it was told from generation to generation about the tabernacle in the wilderness and what they built. They knew this. It's the first gate of entrance into the outer court of the tabernacle of Moses. In other words, the only way to come in was through the way. And Jesus is saying, I'm the way. I'm it. There's not another way. It's me. Exodus 27. For the gate of the court, there shall be a screen 20 cubits long, woven of blue, purple, and scarlet thread and fine woven linen made by a weaver. It shall have four pillars and four sockets. All the pillars around the court shall have bands of silver. Their hooks shall be of silver and their sockets of bronze. I want you to pay attention to the details. The length of the court shall be 100 cubits, the width 50 throughout, and the height 5 cubits, made of fine woven linen and its sockets of bronze. All the utensils of the tabernacle for all its service, all its pegs, and all the pegs of the court shall be of bronze. The gate is blue, speaking of revelation, Jesus is Lord. Purple, royalty. Jesus is King. The scarlet, the blood, Jesus is our Savior. The fine woven linen, Jesus is holy and he is our sanctifier. The curtain all around, and I could go into the dimensions and I'm not going to go there today. Fine woven linen, what was Jesus buried in? fine linen. The sockets made of silver, representing redemption. Bronze is a strong metal, enduring affliction and suffering. When you look at Jesus and you look at this gate, you completely see what Jesus did for us. Isn't it amazing? All woven in. Then you go into the outer court. The outer court is the place of offerings and sacrifices, cleansing and preparation. It's a place of the priestly activity, fulfilling the requirements of the Lord under the old covenant, and it was all fulfilled in Jesus. The first thing you come upon, the next slide, is the bronze altar, or the altar of the burnt offerings. This is a place where the sacrifice for the redemption of sin was given. It's the place where in the Old Testament they would come and they would lay their sacrifice over that altar, and it had to be completely burned up. It had to be sacrificed to pay the redemption price for the people's sin. And they had all kinds of rules and regulations about what they would bring for this or that and different things, but Jesus fulfilled the totality of it. Now, one of the things I want to say to us, Jesus fulfilled it all, but then what does Scripture say? It says that we are crucified with Him. So when we come to Christ, we come to that brazen altar, and we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes when I'm not wanting to offer myself on that altar, I just have to say, Lord, tie me to the altar. Make me willing to be willing. Anybody else ever prayed that one? Because you know what the priests would do? They would tie that sacrifice on that altar. So sometimes I just say, God, tie me on this altar. Because I know that my flesh is going to want to get up and run. And the Lord says, no, 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 no. If you will yield your members as dead to yourself, but alive to me, you'll live. See, dying is the pathway to living. We are crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, we live. Yet not I, but Christ who lives in me. That's the action that happens here. The very first place into the tabernacle. Because I want you to see this tabernacle as a journey. Not just something you're looking at, but I want you to see it as a journey that you're walking through. Then there's the bronze laver. Interesting thing about this bronze laver, it was made out of the mirrors that they had brought out from Egypt. And they gave it to the priests when they got ready to build, and the artisans. When they got ready to build the tabernacle, they brought their bronze mirrors and they hammered them together. Now, what happens when you look into a mirror? You see yourself, right? What happens if you look into clear water? But there's something unique about this. That water represents the water of the Word. What does Scripture say? By the washing of the water of the Word. So when you look in to this laver, because you are already crucified with Christ, nevertheless you live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me, right? You've gotten up off of that bronze altar, and you've come to the bronze laver, and you look in, you don't see the dirtiness of sin. You see the reflection of what the Word of God says about you. It's no longer you who live, but Christ who lives in you. So when you look in, you're going to see a reflection of Christ in you, the hope of glory. That ought to make you happier than it's making you. See, there's a reflection. Now, sometimes, because we live in a dusty world, we live in a fallen world, we live in a world where all kinds of things happen, we flub up. Anybody else flub up? So you get to this place, you've already been crucified, so you don't, with Christ, so you don't need to go back there. But sometimes we do need to be washed. But do you remember what Jesus said when they were at the Last Supper, what did he wash? Just their feet. He didn't wash all of them. He just washed their feet. Do you know in the Old Testament they had to wash their hands and their feet, but at Jesus they only washed their feet? Do you know why? Because it's only about washing our walk. You walk in a dusty world. Your feet get dirty. And Peter said, wash all of me. And he goes, no, you have no need that I wash all of you, just that I wash your feet. See, this will set you free from condemnation. Because the enemy comes to accuse. The enemy comes to try to say, you've messed up so bad you won't ever make it. And God says to you, no, just come have your feet washed. Let me wash over you with the water of the word. Let me wash the dust off your feet. Let me wash it away. Let the revelation of who God says you are. Look deeply into the reflection of the water of the word. And I've been saying this a lot lately because I feel like it's so key. We have to have a true revelation of who God says we are. We have lived in religious systems and structures for so long that have told us how bad we are and accentuated the sin, pointed to all the horrid. And Jesus says, you're washed, you're clean, you're beautiful. See, part of what we end up losing is the joy of our salvation. Because we're looking at the flaws, and Jesus is saying, no, believe who I say you are. I took all of that stuff to the cross. And even when you still struggle with some temptations and stuff, just take the revelation of who Jesus says and beat the devil over the head. I mean, come on. Let's remember who he says rather than rehearsing what the devil says. Why bronze? Why was it made out of bronze? That even through sufferings, we'll have strength and endurance. See, in this world, you will have struggles. You will have troubles. You will have tribulations. But there is a strength that God has given us by His Spirit through the finished work of the cross that we can endure the sufferings that come. And those sufferings are what God uses to mold us into greater and greater manifestations of who He has for us to be. He's fashioning us. And it's interesting, it's also the brazen laver, it was made out of acacia wood and covered with bronze. Why acacia wood? I did some research years ago about acacia wood. Do you know what it is? It is an incorruptible wood. It doesn't rot. Does that speak of Jesus or what? Because wood often speaks, or trees often speak of leaders. And it speaks of man. And he was the only incorruptible man. He made a way for us. So as we're making our journey, we've come in through the way. We've chosen to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord our God. He said, now, even out of Ezekiel, remember when Ezekiel saw the Lord and fell on his face, and the Spirit of God came in him and stood him on his feet? This is what happens right here. He takes us and he stands us on our feet, and he says, now walk to this laver. Look in and see who I say you are. Allow the water to wash your feet. And let it just wash away completely. Because then you're standing, not by the flesh, but by the Spirit. And then he says, would you come on in with me? Because see, he doesn't leave us in the outer court. See, in the Old Testament, all they could do was outer court. But through Jesus, we get to go on in. Hallelujah. Then you begin to go into what is the tabernacle. The tabernacle consists of the holy place, which is the inner court, and the holy of holies. It represents the soul and the spirit, because we know we're a tripart beings. We've got the flesh, we got our body, we got our soul, and we've got our spirit. And then it has the holy of holies. It is the dwelling place of the manifest presence of God. God Almighty, Holy Spirit, dwells inside of you. From Exodus 36, 8 through 38, and I'm not reading the whole passage, I'm just giving some highlights. The curtains are woven of fine linen of blue and purple and scarlet thread with artistic designs of cherubim they made them. Recognize the colors from before? Do you remember the cherubim guarding over the Garden of Eden? Then there's a second curtain over the top that is of goat's hair for the tent over the tabernacle that speaks of the prophetic anointing pointing to righteousness and sanctification. Then there's a third covering for the tent made of ram skins dyed red. Well, who won't know what that is? It speaks of Christ being the sacrificial offering for our redemption. And then the fourth covering is that of a badger or an animal hide, a leather, that is above that. And it is Christ as the covering of protection, the shield over us. So when you're coming into the holy place, out from the outer court, you're going in. Can you imagine how dark it would be with all that fabric over it? Those are heavy. It's intense. They're hung all the way around. You're going to see this in a minute. They're hung all the way around. This can continue. For the tabernacle, he made boards of acacia wood. Remember it again? Same wood. Standing upright. He overlaid the boards with gold, no longer with bronze, but with gold. Made their rings of gold to be holders for the bars and overlaid the bars with gold and also made silver sockets for underneath the boards. Do you see the prophetic symbolism? It's just fascinating to me. And you have a veil of blue, purple, and scarlet thread and fine woven linen, artistic design of the cherubim. That's the one leading into the Holy of Holies. So we've seen the veil leading into the holy place. Now we see the veil leading into the Holy of Holies. And the screen for the tabernacle door is blue, purple, and scarlet, and fine woven linen. Look at the next picture, and hopefully you'll be able to see this. The gold represents the glory, the silver, redemption, bronze, strength, and suffering. The acacia wood, incorruptible man. The woven fabric, Jesus is Savior, Lord, and King. The goat's hair, the prophet and the sanctifier. The ram skin dyed red, the Savior and Redeemer. The badger skin, our protector. It's all about Jesus. See, God showed them Jesus from the very beginning. I just love that. So remember, we're going in, but with all of this, it's dark inside until we get inside. Look at the next slide, the interior. And we will unpack all of this briefly here. You see the screen, which is Jesus, the truth. Then you see the golden lampstand, the table of showbread, the altar of incense. Beyond the altar of incense, you see the next covering, which is the veil, Jesus, the life. So now we know why the people in Israel were so upset when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then you go into the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant is, and the glory. Resting upon the throne. Jesus, the truth. John 1:17 says, for the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. He is the truth. Jesus said, I am the truth. It's the entrance into the inner court, the holy place. Listen to this. It is a gate into communion by spirit and truth in worship and intercession. It's the gateway where you enter into an intimacy with the Lord. Go to the next. And then go to the next one. Now imagine you've come in. I'm going to do the rest of this right now, Chris, with just this picture because I want us to just focus in on it. You see the lampstand. It represents the filling and the illumination that comes by Holy Spirit. See, when you come in beyond the point of salvation, you step into this inner court. The way light comes is through the fullness of Holy Spirit. He becomes the light that shines into the rest of the tabernacle. It's the place of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And then what happens is this light shines across the room to the table of showbread. And the showbread represents partaking of the word of God. Take and eat all of it. And actually, this word was sprinkled with frankincense. Now, the interesting thing about frankincense is it smells great, but it has a bitter taste. In Ezekiel, he was told to take of the scroll and eat all of it. And it goes on and it says it will be sweetness in your mouth, but bitterness to your soul. What this speaks about is often when we take the word of God, when we begin to eat deeply of the word of God under the illumination of Holy Spirit, there are things he says to us that sometimes our soul goes, really? He begins to talk to us and tell us some things to do, and it's bitter. It doesn't set well with us. It may confront some of our own belief systems. It may challenge us to go and do some things that we don't think we can do. And he's saying, take and eat all of it. Take and partake deeply of my word. Allow my word to completely transform you from the inside out. It's the partaking of the word of God under the illumination of Holy Spirit. And when Holy Spirit has come and filled you and you've partaken of the word of God, the natural response is the altar of incense. Because when the Spirit of God comes and the word of God comes on the inside of you, you can't help but worship and intercede. There is a response that comes. You cannot be filled with the Holy Spirit and with the Word of God and not worship and pray. The fruit of a Spirit-filled life is worship and intercession. Because if the Spirit of God is within you and the Spirit of Christ is Christ's Spirit and He is the one who always lives to intercede for you, how is it that you can be filled with His Spirit and not do what He always lives to do? When I got baptized in the Holy Spirit, the first thing that happened to me is I became a woman of intercession. I was a worshiper, but my worship went to a whole nother level. Because the Spirit of the living God dwelling inside of me led me to be who He is. You have to do what He's doing because He's inside of you. And when as many as are led by the Spirit of God, those are the mature ones. It says the sons of God. That word sons is the weos of God, the mature ones of God. So the more we follow Holy Spirit and Word and allow worship and intercession to come out, the more we are being mature sons and daughters of the Most High God. So at this altar of incense, we're offering up our praise and our intercession in the spirit of truth, Holy Spirit, and the Word. And see, part of what we have been missing in this generation is that we've had churches of the Spirit and churches of the Word. And there's been this great divide between churches of the Spirit and churches of the Word. But here's the deal. We will never have the fullness of the glory of God until the Spirit and the Word come together. The glory of the Lord filled the temple when Solomon built the temple and they dedicated it. When they brought the altar, the brazen altar, up from Gibeah and the Ark of the Covenant from the Tabernacle of David at Zion, and they brought them together, Word and Spirit, and brought it together, and they got glory. When we get to the place where we honor Holy Spirit and honor Word of God equally because they are equal, and we celebrate both, and we yield to both, and we follow both, we'll begin to get glory. So the altar of incense, when the priest would then go into the Holy of Holies, they would take the incense and the incense would lead. Worship and intercession will always lead you into the manifest presence of God. You can't get there any other way. There's no way. And see, the glorious thing about where we are in this, in God's continuum of time, is that veil between the holy place and the Holy of Holies no longer stands. It was rent, not from bottom to top, but top to bottom. God did it. But that veil, if you'll skip over to Jesus the life, Jesus the life, Jesus said in John 11:25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. That veil, the reason it was rent was because he said, I paid the price, now come in and live. I paid the price, come in and live. I am the life, now enter into my life. See, religion says just believe and you'll go to heaven someday. Intimate relationship with the Lord, he says, I have rent the veil, enter into my life. It's not a something that will be. It's something we enter into today. It's the way that when Jesus said, I have come to give you life and life more abundantly. That's not for afterwards. We're to live the abundant life now. And we have been bound in so much stuff. But he says, I tore that veil. Step into my life. Step in. He wants us to enjoy life. He wants to celebrate with us. He wants us to enter in. He says, I am. I'd have the typo on this next slide. Jesus, I am the life. I said truth on this one. Oh, no, I am the way, the life, and the truth. He is the truth. Got some of my notes mixed up here. We go through the veil. Chris, can you fast forward a couple of slides? Jesus, I am the truth. It's the veil of the Holy of Holies. It's guarding the manifest presence of God. It's rent from top to bottom. In other words, the manifest presence of God is no longer guarded by the cherubim that guarded the tree of life. We have access. See, Adam and Eve could not go and partake of the tree of life because in their fallen state, apart from redemption, if they had taken of the tree of life, they would have lived forever in their fallen state. Now, wouldn't that be a horrific existence? But because we have died through agreement with the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, we have access to eat of the tree of life. There is healing in the tree of life. There's deliverance in the tree of life. There's restoration in the tree of life. There is the abiding presence of God at the tree of life. In the Holy of Holies, we come to the Ark of the Covenant. Our God is a covenant-keeping God. El Olam, the everlasting God. He always keeps covenant with his people. We may wander, but he's always steadfast. We see this all throughout the Old Testament when the children of Israel would wander away and God's covenant stayed. And he would raise up a deliverer. He would raise up one to bring them back. I believe we're in a time and season where over this nation that we have gone astray. As a people, we've gone grossly astray. But God has raised up a company of deliverers in our age that believe God for what God has said and are willing to stand up, be bold and courageous, declare and decree what God has said, and we're going to move into a place of restoration. God's releasing Jehu anointings on people to take some Jezebels out. He's releasing some Josiah anointings on some young people who will go through the land and tear down the idols, tear down the high places, and reestablish worship. He's raising up some Hezekiahs. He's raising up some Nehemiahs. He's raising up some Ezras. He's raising up some Esthers that will be bold and courageous. We've got to have it. Because our nation has gone astray, but God says, I'm not done. I'm a covenant-keeping God, and I made a covenant with this nation at the beginning. Well, who will believe what I said? Won't believe what he said. See, the Ark of the Covenant represents the dwelling and abiding place of the Lord. It also represents his government. It's his throne. He is seated above the cherubim. The foundation of his throne is righteousness and justice. And this week the Lord says, you've always talked about the foundations being righteousness and justice, but I declare to you that the seat is truth. Because you will never have righteousness and justice apart from truth. We have a lot swirling in our culture right now that's proposing itself as truth that's not truth. We're calling truth, lies, and lies, truth. We're calling good, evil, and evil, good. It's time for some people with the word of truth in their mouth to rise up and be bold and courageous. Part of the reason we're in the fix we're in right now is we decided to be politically correct, be nice, be soft-spoken, meek, and mild. And while we've been soft-spoken, meek, and mild, our world has been taken captive by the God of this age. And I know And there are a whole lot of people that want President Trump to be nice, mild, meek, and polite. He is a Jehu. Get over it. And if you go study the life of Jehu, he was a wild man. They would see him coming on his chariot. Is that Jehu? He's running like a chariot, running like a Jehu. He didn't care what people thought. Now, I'll tell you, part of what my prayer is for President Trump is that he does not end like Jehu ended. Because Jehu finished his assignment and took out Jezebel. But then he fell away from the Lord. So part of what we have to pray is don't let him fall away, but let's pray he finishes his job. Because Jezebel over this nation needs to go, and it takes a Jehu. We got to have some Jehus that rise up in the church too, I'll just say it. Don't try to be a Jezebel around here. I'll just say it. Hebrews 9:11 says, but Christ came as high priest to the good things to come with the greater and more perfect tabernacle not made with hands that is not of this creation. Somebody say hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, that was a pattern. First Corinthians 6:19. Or do you not know that your temple is the temple of Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? I've said this before, but I'm going to say it here again. That word you is not singular. It's plural. Do you know not know that you all, y'all, good Southern girl here, y'all are the temple of the Holy Spirit? Yes, he dwells inside of you, but to be the temple is that we're living stones fitted and knitted together to become the living tabernacle of the Lord. I'll read it, Ephesians 2, 19 through 22. There's another 2:22 verse coming. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints. We're fellow citizens with each other. And are of God's household, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole building, say whole building, being fitted together is growing into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also being built together into the dwelling of God in the Spirit. That is God's purpose. I'm going to read this to you in the Passion. So you are not foreigners or guests, but rather you are the children of the city of the holy ones, with all the rights as family members of the household of God. You are rising like the perfectly fitted stones of the temple, and your lives are being built up together upon the ideal foundation laid by the apostles and prophets. And best of all, you are connected to the head cornerstone of the building, the anointed one, Christ Jesus himself. This entire building is under construction and is continually growing under his supervision until it rises up completed as the holy temple of the Lord himself. This means that God is transforming each one of you into the Holy of Holies, his dwelling place, through the power of the Holy Spirit living in you. Isn't that glorious? So see, it's tabernacle. God dwelling in me. Tabernacle, God dwelling in us. This week, as we're going through the Feast of Tabernacles, I want you to walk through the tabernacle of Moses. I'm going to take a couple of minutes, and I want you to go on a quick journey with me in intercession. Because there's something that happens when we get to the place of the Holy of Holies. So, Father, we thank you that you have led us through Jesus the way. I thank you, Lord, that we saw Jesus as the way and that we have come in through him, because there is no other way whereby men must be saved. And we've taken a journey, Lord, and today we come to the brazen altar. And afresh and anew this day, October the 4th, 2020, we offer ourselves on this brazen altar as a living sacrifice, according to Romans 12, holy and acceptable unto you. Lord, we offer our life to you, and we say, may it be not I who live, but Christ who lives in us. We choose this day to say that I have been crucified with Christ, yet I live. Nevertheless, I live. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ who lives in me. Lord, we thank you that our life is not our own. And we choose to yield completely to you, to come into identification with all that Christ did for us, agreeing with you when you say that he took all our sin, took all the curses, he took it all to the cross. And we come into an agreement with that And we thank you. And even as Ezekiel was, he was in that place of laying out before you in awe and wonder. So too are we, God. But by your Spirit, we stand on our feet, filled with the life of God, and we move forward to the bronze laver. And by faith, Lord, we look in. And Lord, as we look in, I'm asking that for each person in this room, you would speak a word to them about what they see. Lord, that they would see what you see. That you don't see the mess. You see the purpose and destiny. You see the grace and the glory. You see that you were created before the foundations of the earth. You see the books that were written over their life. You see that they have been made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, that they are the redeemed of the Lord. They've been clothed in robes of righteousness, no longer clothed in shame. They are the apple of your eye, and they are your beloved. That you have washed them from all unrighteousness, and you have made them into sons and daughters of the Most High God through the blood of Jesus. And Lord, even one thing I didn't cover is that from this place, then the priest, and I declare that each one have been made a priest unto God according to your word. As they prepare to go into the holy place, they put on their priestly garments, the garments of righteousness, of truth, the garments of holiness, the garments even of the fear of the Lord. And enter in through the truth into the holy place. And I just want to see, I want you to see yourself walking through that veil into the tabernacle of the Lord. I want you to look to your left, and I want you to see the lampstand. And Lord, we gaze upon this lampstand, and we say, Lord, we thank you for Holy Spirit, for the seven spirits of the Lord. And we ask that you would fill us afresh and anew with your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom, of knowledge, of counsel, of might, of revelation, of the fear of the Lord. That you would ignite Holy Spirit in us to illumine us for the journey that we're on. And Lord, even as we're in this holy place, we look across to the table of showbread. And Lord, I'm saying, God, let the light of revelation come upon the Word of God. Lord, even this week, cause revelation to come upon the Word of God as we read, as we meditate, as we pray. Lord, that you would unlock mysteries, that we would take and eat of your Word deeply, and that it would change us from the inside out, that it would become life itself to us. Jesus said that he had bread to eat that his disciples knew not of, and it was to do the will of his Father. Lord, as we partake this week, may it be revelation to us to do the will of our Father. And out of the Holy Spirit and the Word, God, we come to the altar of incense and we lift up our praise and our prayers to you. God, I'm praying for each of us that this week, that as we walk through this place of the Feast of Tabernacles, that you would ignite such a passion of Holy Spirit and your Word in us, that worship and intercession would arise out of us, that is born out of heaven, that is born out of your Word, that is born out of your Spirit, not out of what we see in the natural, but born out of what is born out of the Spirit. Lord, ignite our prayers that they may arise before you as a sweet-smelling fragrance, holy and acceptable unto you. Lord, let our prayers rise. Let the bowls of intercession be tipped over. And Lord, let the sound of our prayers and our intercession go before us as we enter into the Holy of Holies. And Lord, in all the other places of the tabernacle, there's activity that goes on. There's the human activity, the priestly duties out in the outer court. There's our interaction with you in the holy place. God, when we come into the Holy of Holies, no flesh can glory. You speak. The weight of your glory comes down. The unlocking of revelation comes. You speak out of heaven, and we respond. And from this place, Lord, saturated in your glory, then you send us out. You send us out beyond that outer veil as carriers of your glory. Carriers of your light. Carriers of your truth. Carriers of your anointing. Carriers of your government. That everywhere we go from this place of saturation in you, we carry you with us. And then we come back. And then you send us, and we come back, and you send us. So, Lord, as we tonight thank you for your presence, we thank you for the kabod, the weightiness of your glory. We invite you, change us. Transform us. Empower us. And send us into the days ahead. There is such a grace on the revelation of the tabernacle of Moses. I've been teaching this and leading people through this prayer like this for probably 27 years. And never have I done it that we didn't enter into the presence of God like that. And I'll tell you, when we use it as a pattern of prayer, personally or corporately, God honors it. I stumbled on it. To be honest, I stumbled on it. God started giving me the revelation. I was digging. I was fascinated with all the intricate details. And he said, start using it as a prayer pattern. And when you do it as a prayer pattern, even personally or corporately, when you get to this place and we begin to hear what he's saying, it's where your strategies come. And it can be strategies of intercession. It can be strategies for your job. It can be insights. It can be those governmental decrees we need. But they come in this place. When you try to do them out here, you create them. And we're pretty good at doing that because we're an ideas people. But when you get here, no flesh can glory. And God can speak one thing and shift everything you need shifted. So in this place, if you are going to Ohio this week, I just want you to come stand up here. I know everybody's going to be participating, but I really felt like the Lord said, for those who are going, just come stand up here. Because I want us to be sent. Part of being an apostolic house is we don't just go, we get sent. And I would like to ask Beth and Sam, Claire, and I'm actually going to impose on Pastor Tommy and Elaine, if y'all would come, Claire. And I just want y'all to stand in a place of praying over us to send us to Ohio, because we're on a strategic assignment. We're not just going to a conference. This is an assignment for the nation. And if God gives you something to pray, pray it. And if not, just act in that place. So on behalf of all of us, Lord, we submit ourselves to you. We want to be vessels that do what you want us to do. To say what you want us to say. To talk to who you want us to talk to. And we trust you for divine protection, divine guidance, and divine opportunities. So we come as surrendered, submitted vessels for your glory and your honor.
Okay, Father God, I thank you right now, Father God, as this company of people go, we give you praise and honor and glory for what you're doing in the nation at this time, Lord. That they would tap into your very heart. Right now, Lord, Father God, it has been said that whoever takes Ohio takes the nation. Father God, I thank you right now, Father God, that you're taking the nation on this trip, Lord, as they go, Lord. I thank you for the insight and revelation from the throne room, Lord, Father God. And we give you praise right now, Father God, for the oil of imprint. That they shall leave in this place, Lord, that it shall be your heart and your voice, Lord. Father God, and Father God, we give you praise and honor and glory, that it will be recognizable, Lord, and unforgettable, that you're making a statement in this time, Lord, and this is not just another trip, Lord, but Father God, that you're putting your imprint on this nation in this time and in this season. So we give you praise and honor and glory. I speak the blessing of the Lord and your spirit, the kabod of your spirit resting upon this people in this time on this trip in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Apostle Jackie, I see a key in your hand. Oh. And in that key, the Lord has given you a key. And I see him sharpening your words. You have a huge key when you speak. Oh, I see the Lord. Oh, you're going to encounter him before you go, and you're going to have a precise word and key. And it's going to be a fire, and it is going to be so precise. You're not going to even have to search for it. It's going to come in such a way. Oh, Father, I thank you. I thank you, Father. You have equipped this woman. I am so honored to know her, Father, to be with her and to partner her with her, Lord. Oh, Father, I thank you for the timely word that you have given her in this time and this hour. And I speak release. Yes, yondona mahaya de mondash yingandonre ba yondore basiandori kianda. Melio sunda bahaya. Mevrosia na mandesh. Nelondore kialabasia.
Even as we were in prayer earlier today, I saw just waves of fire dropping and hitting the people in the prayer room. And the Lord God says, you don't even have to worry about what you're going to say, because I'm going to drop fire into you, and you will be positioned strategically with my word and my anointing for such a time as that. Go forward with a confidence that I am with you, and I will deliver the word of the Lord through you.
So I heard the Lord say to everyone that's going that this will be an advancement in the kingdom of God in your life. And the Lord said you're stepping into a holy time, an anointed, appointed time. The Lord is giving you declarations of a governmental strength. So even when you come back from Ohio, that there will be a turnaround in your lives, says the Lord. There'll be a strong anointing. Things that you said and thought that you could never do, the Lord said, I am giving you now the strength and the courage, because you have been part of a history-making event that I have put on your hearts to go to be part of. And wherever you put your feet, says the Lord, you will take the land and you will bring back the booty, says God. You will bring back the reward that will come over and shine on you. And Jackie, I heard the Lord say, I keep seeing the lampstand. The lampstand. He's going to baptize you into the seven spirits, says the Lord. I am anointing you to a higher place, says God. And you will know revelation upon revelation upon revelation, because I have caused a trust in you between the two of us. And you have been loyal and faithful to the places that I've told you to go, and even the hard things that you have done. And God said, I'm opening up a place in the spirit realm that many have desired to come, but I am only giving them to the ones that I trust. And I see you going into a global ministry. This is a door that's opening up a nation and nations. Oh, we thank you for it, Lord. We thank you, Father, that she carries it well. She carries her mantle well, Lord. And you are so pleased with her. Bless them, Lord. Bless them all. Safely going, safely coming. Nothing missing, nothing broken. Nothing missing, nothing broken from any of this troop that you're putting together, Father. Fire in their bellies, Lord. Fire when they sleep. Fire when they pray. Fire when they intercede, Father. A new and a fresh anointing and fire on them all, God. I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Father God, we just plead and apply your blood upon this team. We thank you for a spirit of humility, Lord God, and the grace that you have placed upon them, Lord. We thank you for their families that will be back home. We thank you, Father, for that removing all distractions, oh God. Remove all sickness, Lord. We pray healing upon them right now in the name of Jesus. We just bind the spirit of COVID-19 in the name of Jesus. No weapon formed against them shall prosper. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your divine covering, your divine protection, oh God. We give you glory and praise for the opportunity. Lord, we thank you for raining on them, Lord, like never before, God. We thank you, Lord, for the joy of the Lord being their strength. In Jesus' name, Lord God, we glorify you and we magnify you. In Jesus' name, thank you, Jesus. Thank you,
Jesus. Hallelujah. So, Father, right now in the name of Jesus, I send us all into this next week, that we walk through this week of tabernacles and move in to the appointed place of the gate of tabernacling with you for your kingdom purposes on earth as it is in heaven. I bless you all. We will not have class Tuesday night, just so you know.
go forth in the power and the might of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good night. And come get your forms up front on the One Race for Life.